Now, coming to our theme, the theme of death in Savitri. So, we have different kinds of knowledge, different layers of knowing according to the deepest or highest spiritual wisdom. One, of course, we are all familiar with is scientific knowledge, which is, as the mother says, it's about a knowledge of the appearances, how things are on their surface. And the means is senses, the gross material senses, and the rational analytical mind through which we process the data and arrive at an understanding of how things operate. Then behind this scientific knowledge, of course, they interpenetrate into each other, and science itself has now entered the occult domain. Mother speaks of it. We read a little bit yesterday that when we talk about a brief period during which we can bring back the soul back to the body. Of course, it doesn't use the word soul, but to bring life back. Basically, unwittingly, we are speaking of an occult phenomena, near-death experiences, etc., etc. Many others in the world of physics. Then there is the occult knowledge, which is about what is behind the appearances. So there is a whole series of worlds, their forces, energies, beings, the lower triple world, the subtle physical, the vital, with all its multiple layers, ranges, the mental world, and all of them are acting upon the human body at any given moment. They are acting in the whole creation, but at least what is relevant to us. And occult knowledge concerns with all these forces. And its means is developing the subtle senses through which we can begin to become aware of these forces, their movement. Of course, they also come as a result of grace. And this is a whole domain of knowledge which one can acquire, how to intervene there and how to intercede, how to change things, change destiny, fate by a kind of intercession. This is occult knowledge. Both scientific and occult knowledge are regarded in Indian tradition as an inferior kind of knowledge, often called as ignorance, not condescendingly. Simply, it means it's a partial knowledge. It doesn't know the real basis, the real truth behind things. Then comes the higher knowledge, the spiritual knowledge. And this knowledge concerns the soul, the self, the divine, how to arrive at that, how to achieve that state of self-realization, or going still further, a state of nirvana, or going still deeper, a state of utter union with the divine. So that's another kind of knowledge, and this comes through intuition, meditation. This is a different process altogether. Its door opens through the human soul or from the peaks of the mind, and we come in touch with these. In the supramental knowledge, all these different types are put together. That's the beauty. That otherwise, traditionally, they are separate. So, people who are practicing occult knowledge were occultists, and normally spiritual people with a spiritual knowledge look down upon them with disdain, that they are, you know, caught up in all this what is called as meaningless things of lower nature. It has nothing to do with the real higher purpose. On the other hand, people who were dealing with let's say science and even occult knowledge to an extent, they looked upon spiritual life as something which is either remote or probably non-existent. Of course, not the occultists, but they preferred this kind of more handy knowledge, which is the occult knowledge gives. But we see in the supramental knowledge, all these three modes come together and are fused into one. That's what we are noticing in Savitri. For example, and particularly in death, the chapter on death, one can see it very interestingly, because death is a watershed. We have the scientific part in it. After all, the heartbeat stops, the breath stops. Then there is, so we saw that description of the scientific part. There is a pain in the heart. Doctor would say, diagnose it as myocardial infarction for whatever reason. Then there is the occult element, how there is a separation taking place because of the subtle nerves. So just as we have a physical nerves corresponding to it, there is a whole set of subtle nerves. And through that, the being is tied. That's why the nervous system is extremely sensitive to occult things. Many people are very sensitive. They get restless. They get, nerves have to be strong, calm. We often hear, because this is the meeting junction point between the other worlds, hidden worlds, and the physical world. So we read a little bit about that, how there is a detachment taking place and how death pulls, how we can delay this process, which is not a good thing, by clinging either through our subtle senses or through the heart, which delays the departure and makes it very difficult, because it's like, imagine somebody is being pulled by two hands in two different directions. Of course, here one side is Yama, the other side is the divine himself. So it's okay. Ultimately, we know that divine is going to win after a long journey. But even Savitri lets him go, because otherwise he'll be torn apart. So, but ordinarily, when, you know, we ignorantly try to clutch and cling, it creates a tremendous downward pressure. Whereas that's not what Yama is there for. He's to take the being ultimately upward, and from there he has to pursue the cycle of rebirth, as the case may be, or deposit in some safe corner from where the person can go directly into Brahman, the rare kind of departure. Then there is also the spiritual aspect, which we very passingly sometimes should have been in one or two lines will reveal great truths. The last moments of Satyavan, which he describes here, before he slumps, he dies, collapses. Now, very often we hear about the moment of death and the dying man's wish. And this question was asked to Mother. Mother says, it's not something fixed. You can delay it, you can, you know, the soul has the ultimate choice. So, as Shobinda puts it very interestingly, that there is a freedom in every phase of fate. The soul can accept or refuse its fate. So what happens? Ultimately, it reaches a point where it decides, no, I must go. So we see that Satyavan says, before I die. That's how those two lines. So he is decided to die. But what he does, the last moment's wish, he says, Savitri, 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 let me lie in your lap. So he has also revealed to us in these two magnificent lines through Satyavan that what should be our state when we depart? To surrender to the divine and whatever he does with us. And that's what Satyavan has done. So moment of death, this is emphasized in the Gita. And when Sri Aurobindo was asked that, is it true that the thoughts at the moment of death are so important? We have fantastic stories, of course, that, you know, there was a man who named his son Narayan. So when he was dying, so he needed a glass of water. So he called Narayan, Narayan. But he was a most wicked fellow. But simply because he called his son Narayan, Narayan, suddenly when Yama appears, you know, he has to stay away, because Narayan says, no, he has called me. Now, Sri Aurobindo was asked, he said, no, it doesn't work like that. You are quoting the Gita, but you must see this sloka in conjunction with the other sloka. The other sloka is that all your life, in the battle of life, remember me and fight. Then this applies. It's not like, as he says, a last minute edifying Christian death, where you are suddenly baptized. You know, there are very interesting jokes about it, that there was a bear, suddenly he caught hold of a priest and the bear was going to eat the priest. And the priest suddenly remembered something. He sprinkled water on the bear and said, you know what, now you are a Christian, so be a good Christian. So the bear concentrates for a while and then he says, Lord, thank you for granting me my food. And, you know, he goes ahead. So, <it's> so, you know, human nature doesn't change. It's a very interesting story, that short story, that human nature doesn't change through in this sudden last minute. If all our life, we have lived the life of a bear, last minute if we get, you know, baptized or some holy man comes and says, okay, fine, you remember Krishna or you remember someone, it doesn't work out, because you have lived a whole life which is miserable. So, third thing, during death, as we are reading, just before that, the mind gets so disoriented that one is not even in a position really, at least the outer being, to try anything. So one has to lead a life inwardly, which is beautiful, turn toward the divine, and then it helps. So in that context, we have in Indian thought, this is uniquely, I have not found it in Tibetan Book of the Dead or, you know, there are some very interesting occult books on death. One of them is Tibetan Book of the Death. It deals a lot about the rites and rituals, little bit about the other worlds. Of course, there is also the book by Swami Abhedananda. I mean, all these books during my study of death I had gone through. But nowhere I found this kind of detailed knowledge. Not even Garur Puran. Garur Puran is frightening. I don't know if people read it. I mean, after departure, thank God, if they read before dying, they would give up. This Narak and that heaven, and you know, you are swinging between the two. And the mother clarified, these are all our mind's projections, much of it. So it's again a mixed thing. Though it has a lot of occult elements in it. We shall see from time to time. But one of the truths that we find even in the Prishna Upanishad, and which Shurvindo says, yes, there is a truth in it, is that there are two paths. Why? Because we are reading now the path that is to be taken. So there are two paths of departure. So these two paths are called Devyan and Pitrayan. So Devyan is the northern path. What it means is that there is an ascension, and the rarest of rare yogi departs through the Kapal, through the Brahmarandra. He bursts it open and he passes through that. And other, those who have developed will go through the eye, some through the mouth. Then there is, you know, suddenly some people through the lower organs, where, you know, suddenly they will pass last minute feces or something, and they depart through that. Now, this Devyan is considered only those who have devoted their life turning towards the divine in some way or the other, but could not really arrive at that. Yogis don't need, because yogis choose their time, they choose their moment, they choose their process. They will go through this Brahmarandra very consciously. But otherwise, they can't be bound by any laws. But otherwise, people who have tried to lead a good life, turn toward the divine, they go through this Devyan. And so they avoid much of the problems. But this is very rarest of rare. That's how the Upanishad and the Purana mentions. So what happens when you depart through this? You have still not arrived. So, but you are allowed to meditate on some of the higher planes, and then you ultimately can merge into Brahman. That's how the thing puts it, and you don't have to come back. But most people go through Pitrayan, the southern path. So here, if you have led a life of merit, but always with ego, philanthropy, altruism and things like that, or you have prayed to the gods, worshipped to the gods, offered them various things, then you remain bound to this lower hemisphere. And therefore, you go through Pitrayan. Even those who have worshipped the gods, they go through Pitrayan. They don't go to the highest worlds. And they will, depending on whom they have prayed and what is their patti, you know, as they say, they dwell on different levels, and then they get back because they have not arrived at the highest status. So, but Shurbindo, as we will see, he combines the two very beautifully in this journey. Because initially he will go, Satyavan is taken through the downward path, and then he is taken through the upward path. Both we will see the description here. So we start with that, 576. And we'll see many occult elements coming together. A detail which we don't really find anywhere. Page 576, last two lines. But now the impulse of the path was felt. So path with a capital P. So as I said, traditionally we have these two paths. Now we'll see, Shobindo doesn't use the word that northern or southern. He's talking about the human soul, which will travel now beyond this point. Moving from the silence that supports the stars to touch the confines of the visible world. So they have to go beyond this visible world into another domain. Luminous, he moved away. Behind him, death went slowly with his noiseless tread, as seen in dream-built fields, a shadowy herdsman glides behind some wanderer from his voiceless herds. So he is also now being talked of as a herdsman. So what is he doing? Like herdsmen from behind, they say, ha ha, they give direction to the, and very meekly the bullock or the cattle follows. So the soul is going ahead, but he gently steering the way. He knows the way. Death knows the way. That's why there is a very interesting prayer of Sri Aurobindo where he speaks of the various gods. Be wide in me, O Varuna. Be voluptuous in me, O Indra. It goes like that. And then he speaks of death and he says, "O death, lead me from mansion to mansion." He knows, death knows all about the dark worlds. And in the end he says, "Liberate me from all these gods, O Kali." So he says, they will all do their job, but at the end you have to be free from all of them after they have done their job. So one has to gather this knowledge, which was part of an integral knowledge in ancient times. So from behind he is gently steering the soul. So not like it is shown that he is tying a noose and dragging like this, you know. He's not that cruel also. He's just doing a job, bad job, whatever it is. And Savitri moved behind eternal death. Her mortal pace was equaled with the gods. So again we see the word eternal coming along with, because thus far he has been the boss. And he will be required as long as there is ignorance. And some kind of ignorance will be there in creation. But he's not eternal in the sense of the eternal with a capital E. Wordless she travelled in her lover's steps, planting her human feet where his had trod into the perilous silences beyond. Now starts the description after the break. At first, in a blind stress of woods she moved, with strange inhuman paces on the soil, journeying as if upon an unseen road. Now, you know, one wonders why Shubhendra describes in so much detail the path. He can just say that, you know, so Savitri followed death. That's how it's described in most of the places. Why is to describe through this means he's giving us a very, very exact, detailed and profound knowledge of how the journey actually takes place. He's already given us a hint through Satyavan that what happens immediately after departure. This is a disorientation. You don't know whether you are on earth, whether you are in some other place, and you are groping and searching, you are feeling with your senses, you are looking for probably somebody whom you love, but you may not remember even who is this person. So you feel the tug, etc., through Satyavan's initial moments. But now he has to describe the whole passage. Around her on the green and imaged earth, the flickering screen of forest ringed her steps. Now it's like a borderland between the physical and the subtle world. It's still, you know, first he goes through the borderland. And it's really only somebody who has experienced it in great depth and detail several times can write like this. And of course, Aurobindo had, when someone asked him about Narad, he didn't give a philosophical answer or symbolic answer. A mother was asked. Mother said, Aurobindo once told me that he saw him flying on the borders of the overmind. It's as cool as that. He saw him flying on the borders of the world. Now, you know, it's not like philosophically, you know, Narad represents, he is a bhakta of the Lord, that whole history, geography we read. He saw it. So Savitri is that kind of knowledge which he has seen. He has experienced several times. He has walked this way. So he can describe it in great detail. Around her on the green and imaged earth, the flickering screen of forests ringed her steps. Now forest, you know, it's not just trees. And he'll describe very beautifully. Its thick, luxurious obstacle of boughs besieged her body, pressing dimly through in a rich realm of whispers palpable. So she is now, you know, getting out and moving. The subtle body will feel even this sense of the physical obstacles, but she is moving through it all. And all the numerous beauty of the leaves rippled around her like an emerald robe. So the experience is very different. It's no more like solid objects, but like on a water you are moving, and yet there is a sense of obstacle. Mother speaks about it when she describes the subtle physical world. And she says that, you know, she was asked that, people had funny things to ask, but of course a very interesting question, that subtle physical is very close to the gross physical. So what happens if somebody gets up from a place and, you know, something of the subtle physical may still be there for a moment, or somebody who is sitting in the subtle physical body and a person with a gross body comes and sits there. So all these things she has answered because she has actually experienced them. So subtle physical is so close, one can almost feel it. Sometime when people have got up and gone and something of that body may still be there for a short while, people with a developed inner sense can just sense it. So this is even environment and places have their subtle physical counterparts. And of course we know the famous words of Mother and Shubindo, that Shubindo dwells in the subtle physical, just round the corner. But round the corner, I wish it was as simple as that. But yes, it's round the corner. He can see us. We may not. That's a different problem that we have to figure out. But more and more, this grew an alien sound. All these sounds are suddenly appearing as if they are coming from far. You know, this is how one experiences, either going out of the body or when one gets into a deeper state. That initially, you know, when we begin to meditate, for example, you'll hear these sounds, then slowly it all turns into a kind of something mixed, and then one plunges inside. This, of course, going out of the body, not about an inner plunge, that will come a little later. And her old intimate body seemed to her a burden which a being remotely bore. Herself lived far in some uplifted scene, where to the transclaimed vision of pursuit, soul presences in a high spaceless dream, the luminous spirit glided stilly on and the great shadow traveled vague behind. Now, you know, it's a different modality through a kind of an inner intuition which has been developed that presences, one begins to hone in. The mother at one time, she said a very interesting story about Nalnida, that how great beings, yogis, they repay what they owe. So when Indulekha Deep, his wife was there and he was here, and there was a person who was taking care of her. So normally Nalnida, with his usual reticent words, he would never say, you know, what he's feeling or a thank you or something like that. But when he died, that time he came to know that this man has died. And he went into his inner trance and discovered where his soul is going, which was gravitating down, picked up, offered at the mother's feet. And mother describes this experience, that how he had his way of repaying it. He literally brought it back and put it at mother's feet. Because it's a whole, how does he know? It's a different kind of identity. Those who come close in soul contact can recognize each other through soul contact. Those who recognize each other through a physical and outer contact cannot recognize when the body is shed. So here it's a soul contact through which she is entering. Then what does she experience? Still within, Shubindu is now blending two levels of experience together. On one side, he is describing about the trees and green. On the other side, the state when one is just going to cross over the border. And this is masterly. He is, of course, the master of masterly poets. Still with an amorous crowd of seeking hands. Now, you know, immediately it gives a feeling, where are the hands coming into this picture? Now, in any place of Shubindu's writings throughout Savitri, there is a consistency of images. He'll not find that suddenly hands will pop up from somewhere. No, it won't happen. So he is describing the trees and the forests. So he's still with the forest and the trees. But he's bringing in a subtle truth of, as we are going out and the soul departs, there is amorous crowd, you know, those who love you, seeking you, trying to hold you, bring you back. But here, these seeking hands, if we see the whole passage is about the trees, look like they are seeking hands, which are, there is another poem of Shubindo, A Tree, where he speaks about a tree beside the sandy river beach, holding its topmost boughs to the skies, like fingers to the heaven they cannot reach. So, you know, that impression. So, we see the whole passage, still with an amorous crowd of seeking hands, softly entreated by their old desires, her senses felt earth's close and gentle air. Now she is feeling the atmosphere of earth. Cling round them, and in troubled branches, new, uncertain treadings of a faint foot wind, the branches, the winds, the atmosphere of the earth, she bore dim fragrances, far callings dust, the wild bird's voice and the winged rustle came. She is still too close to earth. So when we are close to the earth, that's the time when equally it applies that longings, those desires, which usually drop off with the dropping off of the senses, that also is being revealed here. They are still there, clinging, holding on, exercising a downward pull on the soul. As if a sigh from some forgotten world. You know, when we are traveling, going somewhere and suddenly we hear a sigh and we suddenly look back, who is it? So it's like that, a sigh from a forgotten world. That's all. It's not like detailed images, person, but a sigh from a forgotten world. Earth stood aloof, yet near round her it wove its sweetness and its greatness and delight. So again, there is a physical earth and there is a vital equivalent of that earth. And it's very sweet and fragrant. Now this physical earth will have all kinds of things. But the totality of the earth, like, you know, when somebody who landed on the moon and saw the earth from, he had a different experience altogether. Blue tinged earth, and he had the sense of unity within. And he said, you know, we fight for small things, but the earth looks so beautiful from above. More beautiful than the moon looks from here. So similarly, there is the atmosphere of the earth created by, actually every place has its own atmosphere. For example, about the ashram, Shobindo says, there are two atmospheres here. There is the atmosphere of the divine presence and there is the human atmosphere. And he cautions people, don't avoid getting into the human atmosphere. Otherwise, people start feeling restless and they say, I don't know, this time I'm not feeling so good. Or they start feeling, it's okay. But if you touch the divine atmosphere, then it's very different. And Rishabh Chandji put it very nicely that, Mother, when people come here, if they meet us disciples, they will never want to stay here. And if they see you, they will never want to go away from here. So it depends on which atmosphere we come in contact. So just as places have their atmosphere, physical places, trees, groves, they all have their atmosphere. Earth itself has its atmosphere. So he's describing now the atmosphere of the earth very beautifully. Earth stood aloof. Earth is now a little far, but still something it is doing. Even physically, the gravity of the earth acts up to a certain distance. So what is it doing? Round her it wove its sweetness and its greenness and delight. Its brilliance, suave of well-loved vivid hues, sunlight arriving to its golden noon, and the blue heavens and the caressing soil, the ancient mother offered to her child, her simple world of kind, familiar things. This is the beauty of the earth. That's why wherever we may go, there is a tendency to get back to earth, because you don't find what we find on earth is found nowhere. And Mother speaks of it. She speaks of that psychic presence in matter. She says you don't find anywhere. Even gods are attracted. Demons are attracted, because demons also know if they have to upgrade their software, which means if they have to change themselves, they must enter into an earthly body. The gods also know if they have to evolve, they must get into an earthly body. See, all the heavenly abodes are very nice, but after a while you get bored. I mean, Indra's abode, all the time music going on, and you know, how much can you enjoy? You also want the charm and adventure of danger. So adventure and danger is in the dark world, but that also becomes too much. You also want the joy of life. Or if you go into some of these, you know, heavenly abodes of the deities, then you are all the time with one deity, one aspect of the divine. So you want the integrality of the divine, all that we find on earth. So that is the beauty of earth. And perhaps that's what is meant when Lord Rama uttered the famous, when, you know, Vibhishna and others tell him that Lanka is yours, why don't you stay here? It's so wonderful, golden and everything. So he said, Janani, Janmabhumi, Swargadapi Gariyasi. Of course, it's so true even of earth. Janani, Janmabhumi, Swargadapi Gariyasi. It's greater than the heavens. So he says, no, I am not here to stay. I'll get back to my home, because that is greater than the heavens. So this the gifts of Mother Earth, she knows, but now she has to go ahead. But now, as if the body's sensuous hold, curbing the Godhead of her infinite walk, had freed those spirits to their grander road, across some boundaries, intangible bar. Because this earth is pulling back by her atmosphere. Suddenly she discovers, oh, but where are they? They are lost. Because see, death knows its way. Death is not interested a moment. It has done its job. This is another interesting thing, that here death comes. Normally, as per tradition, death directly doesn't come. That fellow is like a king, and he has a very fantastic organization. Mother uses the word, it's a fantastic organization. And she says, yes, there are plenty of beings in it. What is called as Yamdut, and different names in different tradition. So what do these fellows come? They are moving around. So they are waiting. There are some conditions of death. There are always people who are, wanting to die. Of course, superficial wanting is a different thing. As the story goes, somebody said that, it is better to die. And then suddenly Yama appeared. You said something. He said, what did I say? No, I am God of death. You called me. No. Sorry, sir. You misheard me. Perhaps, I think your mobile doesn't work well. you mentioned better to die, something like that. No, not now. Better to die means when I have grandchildren, they are married, they have great-grandchildren. Then it is better to die. So it's not about the surface. But there are situations, Mother speaks of it, there are spirits of death. So they are moving around. Like if there is an accident, so they'll just hone in there. So a psychic being will decide, body is too much broken. I think it's better to leave it. So the spirits of death are there, wanting to take away. But if the soul says, no, I'm not going to go. So even in the tattered condition, broken condition, it'll linger on. And Mother gives interesting experiences of somebody whose brain was crushed, has gone into coma. And everybody has given up. But he doesn't want to leave. So Mother goes there and she says all his elements had fragmented. So she goes there, gathers all the elements, collects them together, brings them together and gives him back. And then, because there is a fear to leave, and then, she calms him that it's okay, don't worry, I'll give you a good new body and stay in my atmosphere, and then the soul decides. So ultimately, the last shot is called by the soul. But the situations are like that. One may feel that, well, it's better to go. Then these fellows will take. But equally, she says, if you say with all your inner conviction, no, I don't want to go, then they will go elsewhere. They have a certain task to fulfill. Like, CEOs give a task. This your project, so many data has to be completed. So they have to take in a certain number of souls and they will take it. They will find their ways and means. And of course, they are very nice agents called diseases and doctors. Doctors are good beings. Sometimes they wear a white coat, no? They are decent people. But sometimes they can also become agents of, I don't want to name. When they feel with fear, your time has come. Who knows, doctor's time has come or the patient's time has come. So, the experience. The silent God grew mighty and remote. As he moves away, he becomes more and more fatter and stronger. In other spaces, and the soul she loved lost its consenting nearness to her life. So suddenly she discovers it's gone. So what do we do next? Now Savitri is a, like you have Yogi Yogeshwar, she is a yogini of yogis. And Mother speaks of this very interestingly. She says, long back, when I used to experience constantly what is called in India as Yoga Agni, then nothing could come near her. But she had to veil all this when she had to enter into the yoga of the cells. So she uses the word yoga, what is called in India as Yoga Agni. So now what does Savitri do? Because she has lost track. So she, into a deep and unfamiliar air, enormous, windless, without stir or sound, they seem to enlarge away, drawn by some wide, pale distance from the warm control of earth, and her grown far. Now they would escape. This is her state. Oh, these fellows have escaped. I was entangled with the earth. Its warmth and its sensuous hold was keeping me back, and they have gone. Now see, there is so much drama in these lines. So what she does, what marvelous line. Then flaming from her body's nest alarmed, her violent spirit soared at Satyavan. No, I have to find him. So suddenly now Shivinda is saying, body's nest, this bird escapes. You know, it's an amazing simile. I have heard about Kabir Das. He describes the same way, bird. But he talks of the body as a ghat. It's like a kumbh or a vessel which holds something. And it escapes and matki phut jati hai. But, you know, that image is a little rough image. What is it? It entered and then it broke it and went away. But look at Shurvinda's image. Nest. It gave the soul a place to experience, go through the experience. That is why when people die in India, one does pranam to the dead body. Someone asks, why do we do? He is no more there. Of course, nowadays we don't do pranam even to a living body. That is a different story altogether. But the logic of this is that here is a body itself which held this divine presence for so long, allowed it to go through certain experiences. And that's something wonderful. You know, we have mother's car. Why do we do darshan? It is a nice number. 10, 12. Meditate upon it. Great truths come out. PY01, 10, 12. You know. But what is its joy? Because it's a chariot on which mother has sat. If supposing we had the chariot on which Krishna and Arjuna sat. I mean, we can open a whole tourist department. We don't even have to find the original chariot. We just have to say this was the original chariot on which Krishna had sat. I tell you, people will pay a lot of money just to have a darshan. So why not the body? Even though the soul has gone from it, it has held the, you know, soul. It's a nest where the soul had made its home, had gone through different experiences. So that we do pranam, and of course we say bye-bye to the soul which is departing, that until we meet again, bon adieu. So, now look at these lines. Her violent spirit, out mid the plunge of heaven-surrounded rocks. The image goes now with this state. She is violent spirit, almost like Kali. So, all the images will now follow that. So, out mid the plunge of heaven-surrounded rocks, so in a terror and a wrath divine, from her airy streams against the ascending death, high streams, indignant at its crouching point of steel. She's not happy. How dare you take Satyavan away? So she is indignant, wrath, terror, violence. See the images. This is something very beautiful in Savitri. The consistency of images. And Shivindu says that, if you see how he has corrected the poetry of different poets. So sometimes one will bring in a strange image and Shivindu will say it doesn't go with the rest of your poetry. There has to be a consistency of images. We can't suddenly, you know, talk about the morning and this thing and suddenly bring in there that I was having food at my home. You know, if you're talking of food, similarly like when he speaks modern images, like in book 2, canto 8, toward the end, he speaks of mart, factory, printing house, all this will be modern images. So we see here all the images and the states blending together. It's the joy of poetry which we can, you know, enjoy as we read. Indignant. Now comes a fierce she-eagle, because she's flying from the nest. A fierce she-eagle threatened in her brood, borne on a rush of puza and a cry, out winging like a mass of golden fire. You see just the beauty of this poetry. And now Shivinda is describing, she came out of the body's nest. So how is she coming out? As an eagle. You see, the beauty of eagle is that it can suddenly accelerate like anything. All other birds, when we see, they will start and slowly they will spread the wings and go. But eagle is a very interesting bird. It can suddenly accelerate. So like an eagle, she feels that her brood is threatened. So she comes out like a fire. She is immersed from a body. So it's such a wonderful image and description. Otherwise, we normally hear of soul as Hansa. But actually, any bird reflects it's usually the soul or his soul power. When one sees a bird in the dream or a flower, they are images connected with the soul. So here he gives the image of the she eagle. That's interesting. Why she eagle? Because she eagle will, when the child is threatened, so he makes it perfect. He could have just said like an eagle. But she eagle is brooding over the and feels threatened and she flies out of the nest. I mean, this is perfect perfection. Supramental poetry. Though Shobhina said supramental poetry is yet to be born, but I mean for us. So on a spirit's flaming outrush bone, she crossed the border of dividing sense. In a jiffy, she crosses it. Where are they? Like pale discarded sheets dropped dully down, her mortal members fell back from her soul. So this happens. The soul actually discards the sheets. But what has she done? She is just like a rope. Ah, I don't need you. You are an obstacle. Get down. And she is flaming up. A moment of a secret body sleep, her trance knew not of sun or earth or world. Thought, time and death were absent from her grasp. So she has come out and entered into a state of wide inner trance. She knew not self, forgotten was Savitri. This, for a brief while, she entered into that trance, comes out of the body and enters into that self from where she must start. And what is she experiencing there? All was the violent ocean of a will, where lived captive to an immense caress, possessed in a supreme identity, her aim, joy, origin, Satyavan alone. What a love this is. It is just a violent will. And what is there in that will? Now Shivinder is using a very interesting image, captive. You know that Janina Stoka's book, Captive of Her Love. What a lovely book it is. So she has made, Satyavan has become a captive of her. We are captive of desires, of earthly beings, this, that. But look at somebody who is a captive of the divine love. What that love can do. So, in her violent ocean of will, where lived captive to an immense caress, caress of the divine mother to the soul, Satyavan, possessed in a supreme identity, she has identified with Satyavan, her aim, joy, origin, Satyavan alone. Her sovereign, prisoned in her being's core, he beat there like a rhythmic heart, herself, but different still, one loved, enveloped, clasped. That is the identity and oneness she gathers, because then only she can discover this. In fact, she says that when people leave away, what she is going to do is, of course, beyond human comprehension. But she says that we must dive, instead of suffering, we must dive deep into our being's core. And there we'll discover the secret oneness. And that secret oneness, if you discover those who are united in their soul, that's why, you know, see how Sri Aurobindo says, who can part those who have grown one in soul within? That is the beauty. So she has realized that unity with the soul of Satyavan. And so she once again goes back, touches this core of unity. Because now this will be the GPS which will tell her which way to go. To discover, because she is so vast beyond, you know. Now, beautiful lines I'll read again. Because, you know, it's to be slave of the divine. Imprisoned by the divine. One would want that. And mother, how she would tell Champak Lalji, we'll just, because it's only one session, we'll just go on for 10-15 minutes, then stop because today is early dinner. So, because, you know, we are crossing the border, so we are also crossing the limits of time. So, you know, when Champak Lalji wants to give his eyes, donate. I mean, this is such a touching incidence. Mother was not in favor of organ donation for those who have consecrated their life to the divine. About others, it doesn't matter. You know, anyways, life is lived in ignorance. So, see, suddenly when he said, I want to donate my eyes, so she puts her hands on his eyes and says, no, 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 they belong to me. Oh, what a wonderful thing, you know. They belong to me. And often people say, but isn't not organ donation a good thing? So I ask them, has any saint ever donated his organs? People think about it as something very spiritual. It is not, it's okay, like philanthropy. So we have already read philanthropy, what it does. And there are occult ramifications of it, which can be very dangerous. Because the body is one, the being is one, the consciousness is one. It must gather everything from the organs. There are actual instances where somebody discovered the identity of the murderer. Because the girl to whom this organ was donated, heart and another instance, the eyes. There are 7 such reported cases I had read at one point of time, authentic. They started having actually the vision of the killer. Because, you know, that eye was transplanted. So while it's okay, you know, people get eyes, there is eye donation, and it's okay at an average human level, blood donation and this donation, that donation is because you're part of a circle of mass. But the moment we begin to consecrate our life to the divine, the effort should be that everything in us is given to the divine. That's completes the cycle, like Pavitrada taking out consciousness from every cell of the body and plunging into the divine. That's the job given to that person. So these lines, her sovereign prisoned inner being's core. He beat there like a rhythmic heart, herself, but different still. So look at the identity and the play of difference. One loved, enveloped, clash. This is the identity of the bhakta and the divine. Shobindo uses this word. He is the very self of the beloved. So bhakta who loves God, God loves him like himself and holds him close to his heart and wouldn't allow him to slip away just like that. So when people ask what will happen after death, this is not a correct question. The current question should be, have I really loved the divine enough? Then the answer is obvious. If one has loved the divine even a fraction, swalpamasya dharmasya, then imagine even good human beings give back a little love in response to love. Imagine the divine. He doesn't forget for lives. There's so many stories of mother, how when she was zone of arc, how Amrita had thrown the cross. He was the priest who had made a cross made of hay and thrown into the fire because she wanted the cross and nobody was daring to give. And that act is remembered. And you know, he is brought so close. So this is the beauty of the divine. So she has loved Satyavan. Satyavan is a captive. He has surrendered himself and she has accepted the surrender. So she won't let his being go to death. She'll fight for him. A treasure saved from the collapse of space. Even when there is pralaya, this remains. Collapse of space. What powerful lines. Around him, nameless, infinite, she searched. Her spirit fulfilled in his spirit, rich with all time, as if love's deathless moment had been found. A pearl within eternity's white shell. So first thing she does is, once again hones into and holds back the soul. So now those looks like he is going the way the death is leading. But she is held the soul captive to her. Now the Leela is taking place in a very different way. So that's the beauty of the divine Leela. Many times, like I think I have given this example. I mean, it's okay to give another example, not from Ramayana, from the Mahabharata, where Krishna is going to Kansa's court and Akrur is very worried. He is a little boy. And you know, what may happen? Krishna says, no, he has called me, I am going. Now what Akrur doesn't know is that it's his will that Kansa is doing. It's not Kansa's will which Krishna is following. That is the external thing. That's what Vasudev reveals to Sri Aurobindo in the jail. That whichever way men do, they cannot do aught but my will. So he sees him in the wakil of who is fighting in his favor. He also sees him in the lawyer who is fighting against him. He sees him also in the judge. So, you know, so this is the kind of identity which he has already discovered now or rediscovers. Then the game begins. Then out of the engulfing sea of trance, her mind rose, drenched, to light streaming with hues of vision and awake once more to time, return to shape the lineament of things and live in borders of the seen and known. So she had gone beyond space and time, secured the central being of Satyavan. Now she comes back to time and this psychic and the journey which is taking place, she will now, the drama will take place there. So she comes back again. What marvelous description this is. So she returns back to the shape, to borders of the seen and known. Onward, the three still moved in her soul scene, as if pacing through fragments of a dream. She seemed to travel on a visioned shape, imagining other musers like herself, by them imagined in their lonely sleep. Now, there is a double state. You know, this description can be very mind-boggling. When as a child I had read Yog Vasishth, I was absolutely confused reading what are they describing. So they are describing a death of one, you know, they are describing about death. And this lady who has died, if I remember correctly, Lilavati, now she is here also, she is there also, she is at a third place also. So I was thinking, what's gone wrong, you know, where all she is not. So again and again I am reading and not able to really figure out that why she is everywhere. But later on, it's possible, and Shobhind is describing that state of Savitri where on one side, she is the being who is holding the whole creation in her arms. She is also one who is holding the central being of Satyavan within herself. And what is the drama of death and this and her following? This is taking place within her vast soul landscape. And the only parallel I find is in the Adhyatma Ramayana where, you know, Sita is asked about Ramayana and she says, oh, I had decided this. What do you decide? I wanted to go with Ravana. Oh, you wanted to go? Yes, yes. I tried to convert him. The fellow won't listen. So Rama had to come. No, I could have destroyed him like this. What is it? Yeah, but I wanted to give him chance. Rama will come. Maybe, you know, at some point, seeing Rama, his mind will change. That's what he almost is on the verge when, you know, he is told by his Nana, Malyavan. Nana or father-in-law, it doesn't matter, one of the Asuras. So he tells him that, look, I mean, why don't you assume the form of Rama and go to Sita, and that's the end of the story. Say that I have conquered Ravana and she will marry you and finish the whole matter. He says, what are you telling me? Just thought of Rama, one glimpse of him, I have gone there and did the puja. It's become so difficult for me to have an evil thought. So see the beauty of the spiritual side of the poetry. Now if I assume his form, do you think I will feel like coveting Sita? I just can't. So have mercy on me, leave me to my form. So here, all this Shobhindo describes so marvelously. She seemed to travel on a vision shape, imagining other musers like herself, by them imagined in their lonely sleep, ungrasped, unreal, yet familiar, old, like clefts of unsubstantial memory, scenes often traversed, never lived in, fled past her unheeding to forgotten goals. So all the aspects, all the beings, something of them, because her being is carrying all of them together, she experiences, and this happens even after death, those fragments of memory, they come near us, like unshaped ideas, even thoughts which we have never fulfilled, all these can come. So unsubstantial memory, scenes often traversed, never lived in. So this also happens that even the world of fantasies, imaginings, they all will come as if they are real. Because we think they are not real. After all, we will just imagine. But they are real at some level. And we have to go past all these worlds. In voiceless regions, they were travelers alone in a new world where souls were not, but only living moods, a strange, hushed, weird country was round them, strange, far skies above, a doubting space where dreaming objects lived within themselves, their one unchanged idea. So this is the, you know, what a ghost is. Ghost is somebody, it's nothing to do with soul. For a change, we should know ghosts are miserable fellows, but vital fragments, say one particular mood, somebody who dies with an intense mood of, let's say, sadness. So that part, so unchanged idea, it keeps moving in that space like an automaton. I don't know whether they sing like beautifully in the movies they show with voice of Lata Mangeshkar and Asha Bhosle, you know, Gum Naam Hai Koi. I don't know whether they can sing like that or not. But then it will be very pleasant ghosts. But they move around. So they are caught up with that one idea, terror or fear. So we have these moods. This is a land she enters where there are moods. But each of these moods, ordinarily we experience these moods is changing. We say, morning I was feeling afraid, now I feel fine. But an intense mood can stay on in that atmosphere. And in after death, there is a space where these moods are gathered. And she experienced that. And these moods are centered around one idea which is not changing. So one is moving around in a space only with that idea. So if one ever encounters a ghost, all that is needed is to tell that fellow, see, there is nothing to fear. Instead, we keep telling ourselves, Hanumanji is near, nothing to fear. We don't need to call. Soul is within, divine is within. What is there to fear? But we should tell the ghost, see, you don't worry. Nobody is there to harm you. Everything is over. Go back. You know, go to your world. And everything is fine. Take it easy. You know, why he tries to threaten us? Because he feels threatened. So if you tell that fellow that, look, you know, you don't have to be afraid, surely he'll go away. I can tell you for sure this is true. And so, you know, she experiences these moods, but alone in a new world where souls were not. So it's not a ghost and not the soul. Shobindu makes it very clear. This is not a world of souls. But what is there? Souls were not, but only living moods. You feel them as living and real. A strange, hushed, weird country was round them. Strange, far skies above. A doubting space where dreaming objects lived within themselves, their one unchanged idea. So that is what they are living with. 3-4 lines and we stop. Weird were the grasses, weird the treeless plains. They are real, unreal at the same time. You know, like we have those imaginations, dark imaginations, morbid imaginations. So all these are real at one level and they have taken shape in these worlds. Weird ran the road, which like fear hastening towards that of which it has most terror, passed phantasmal between pillared conscious rocks, somber and high, gates brooding, whose stone thoughts lost their huge sense beyond in giant night. So this is the world of what we can call as the ghosts, where they are, everything is weird, fixed around the idea. They are traveling on a road which has no end, like lost. They don't know where to go and they are full of fear. So last 4 lines, we'll stop with that. Towards that of which it has most terror. So it's like roads which are afraid. Look at Shivindo's line. Weird ran the road which like fear hastening towards that of which it has most terror. You are afraid. And you are running where? Towards that of which you are afraid. So that is the state in this world of, or it's often called as the Prayt Lok, and you know, this Pindadan done to destroy this world, and there is All Souls Day, etc. We'll talk of it at an appropriate moment. Past, phantasmal between pillared conscious rocks, somber and high, gates brooding, whose stone thoughts lost their huge sense beyond in giant night. So we'll stop here and start tomorrow at 5:15.